Welcome to This Week in the World of Wrestling.
Welcome to TwitWow, the best wrestling podcast made for wrestling fans, by wrestling fans, on the web today. I'm John, that's my cohort and commentary Ashton, and this is our NXT review. And this is going to be a very interesting review of NXT because, well, save for one segment that opened the show, the entirety of the show was Zayn versus Joe, 2 out of 3 falls. So me and Ashton deliberated. We did say that we would talk about this matchup. That's the agreement we came to. And, man, Ashton, these two guys, they put on a clinic.
These guys put on a clinic, and I think when we actually get to the review, I'm going to have a lot to say about what they did right.
All right, very interesting phrasing, because that lends me to believe that you may also have some critiques of this match. For the record, I do as well, if I do have you pegged right. So with that said, let's get right into the first segment, Heat of the Night. Again, because this is a very unusual show, I really don't know if Heat of the Night is the proper terminology here. Yeah. Nothing really about the match ticked me off in that way. I mean, I do have some criticisms again, but nothing really that's like, oh, rah, 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 rage. So, wow.
That was violent.
Exactly. Well, much like this segment usually turns out when you and I, well, mostly me, do have a Heat of the Night. You actually are psychologically healthy, so there you go.
Rabble, rabble, rage.
Rah, rah, rah. So, I'm guessing you're the same way, though, right? Because this is just such a weird show, it's hard to really say Heat of the Night, right?
Yeah, this, you know, honestly, if it wasn't for the fact that Lucha Underground is as amazing as it is, we would have probably live reacted to this show because that's just kind of the format that I feel would have been most appropriate for it.
I completely agree with you because watching this, I was even thinking to myself, we would have been better off doing live reactions.
Yeah.
So, with that said, let us get right into our NXT review. And William Regal opens up this show. He comes out. He immediately addresses, and I like that this is the first thing he addresses, Baron Corbin's attack on Austin Aries last week, says the only reason Baron Corbin isn't being disciplined is because of Austin Aries. Austin Aries requested that William Regal not discipline Baron Corbin. And so at NXT TakeOver Dallas, Austin Aries is taking matters into his own hands because he will be facing Baron Corbin. Now, I like that. I think that's going to be a solid matchup. I think it's going to be a lot like Baron Corbin versus Apollo Crews at TakeOver London, where people may not be expecting much, but I think it's actually going to be one of the standout matches on the show, just my personal opinion. So I'm excited for that. And then we get right into our 2 out of 3 falls match. Before we get into that, I mean, Ashton, do you have anything you want to say about Regal's promo or the announcement of Aries versus Corbin at Dallas?
No, I mean, I think Aries versus Corbin at Dallas makes a lot of sense. I like that Regal kind of made it seem like, you know, in any other situation, Corbin would have probably been suspended. I like that. The one thing that this might have been like irreparable damage that they might have done, it would be now anybody that ever gets suspended, the person that they get suspended for attacking is going to look like a coward because they let the person get suspended.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I get what you're saying. That's a very interesting way of looking at it, and I honestly never even looked at it from that perspective, so I appreciate that. That's a good point. With that said, I mean, here we go. Zayn, Joe, 2 out of 3 falls. Like I said, guys, this is a very weird show.
And I don't think that we need to go, like, play-by-play, let's describe every spot or anything. Let's just, I mean, before we even talk about the, you know, our favorite moments in the match, I want to say, what I loved so much about the way that they went about this match, there was so much that I loved, actually. Okay, first of all, I love that they made it seem like we were going to get more matches, and the match just went so long that we had to move the other matches to next week.
Yes, you know, the last time I remember that happening was back in, I want to say, 2007, Shawn Michaels versus John Cena in London, because I think Edge versus Randy Orton was also scheduled to take place on that show, but Shawn Michaels and Cena, they went for an hour. And so, like, they closed the show out. There was no Edge and Randy Orton until next week. So I like that they did that, too, because here you are expecting, okay, well, this match's got to end any time now. Like, I was even doing the math watching it. You know what I'm saying? Like, okay, yeah, they've taken up this much time, which will leave the segments that the commentators keep saying we're going to get this much time. And then it just dawned on me, like, we're not getting those segments. These guys are going to the bitter end.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I agree with you. I really like that as well.
I like that. I also absolutely – because here's the thing. When you do a 2 out of 3 falls match, one of the things that I hate most about the format is a lot of the times the first 2 falls, it's like the guys have like a negative kickout percentage. Like, I feel like if we ever had like a 2 out of 3 falls match between Baron Corbin and some big name like NXT main eventer, Corbin could get the first fall after a simple, what's it called? G6?
G6.
The spinning side slam that he does.
Deep six.
Deep six, thank you. Because it just seems like the first 2 falls, people are so much easier to pin. It's like they're weakened for the first 2 falls. And then for the 3rd fall, their toughness goes up by a billion. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
Like,
yeah,
the way
that
the format, it's like they get the 2 falls out of the way super quickly. Like, okay, you guys know what's going on here. They're going to trade the first 2 falls. And then the 3rd fall is like the real match.
Right, right.
Whereas with this felt like a legitimate, these guys were trying to beat each other the whole way through.
I agree. That was the one thing I really noted about this matchup, you know, kind of build upon your point. It seems like, especially in NXT, because they've done more 2 out of 3 falls matches, you know, in their history than the main roster has in the longest time. I mean, we just recently had one at Fastlane, you know, Kalisto Del Rio on the kickoff. It seems like the first fall ends so quickly. Second fall gets a little bit more time than the first fall, but then the 3rd fall almost feels like that's the actual match. You know what I mean? But here, it's like they dragged it out. It took forever to even get one fall, so much so that I actually had to remind myself that it was a 2 out of 3 falls matchup when a decision finally came.
Yeah.
So I really, in that respect, I really appreciated the pacing of this matchup.
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty much how I feel, too. I think the pacing was what made it special. I think that that's why, honestly, we probably should have live reacted to it because, you know, the pacing was so good. It was – honestly, if we're being real, this was basically NXT's answer to All Night Long.
Yeah.
One match, one show, and they did that this week, and I appreciated it. I thought that they did – I don't think it was as crazy and, you know, intense and full of high spots and stuff as Puma versus Mundo was. But I think that for, you know, the restrictions that there are on the NXT brand, you know, given that they're not going to, you know, go through tables and do crazy stuff like Mundo and Puma were able to do, I think that they did a really good job.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. You know, I think they worked a different style. I mean, let me just say, while we're just making general remarks and not getting too specific about the matchup, I just love Joe working heel.
Yeah.
Especially this type of heel. I think it works so well. And Sammy is the perfect foil for him.
Yep.
You know, I know I've been kind of hard on Sammy, you know, being back in NXT because I don't necessarily like that he's been thrust into this kind of picture or whatever. But I think them going bell to bell for the whole show, given the story leading up to it, that these guys, you know, one can't seem to definitively beat the other, I thought was a smart move.
Yeah.
And then when you have Joe working heel like he does, just picking a guy apart, and Sammy just, you know, doing everything he can to fight back, it's a great dynamic. So I think in terms of the story and the performers and just everything on that level, this match was great. I mean, this match, I think, at times really elevated into art for me. Again, I do have my problems. I don't know if you want to go over some of your problems first, but I mean, there was a few issues I had. But yeah, this was a tremendous matchup. You know, I enjoyed it.
Honestly, I'm curious what your issues were because I didn't really feel like there were any major issues with this match.
I did feel like it was a little slow in parts. You know, I felt like there were certain moments in the match that kind of plodded along for me, which I get, right? Because when Joe works heel, I've kind of – and this 2 out of 3 falls matchup really illuminated it to me. It's really like a slow – methodical style, you know what I mean? Like picking a guy apart. So obviously it's not going to be quick guns blazing. And to be fair, I didn't expect a guns blazing kind of matchup. I just think it, at points I'm just like, okay, well, we're in a rest hold and he's still just smacking him around. I don't know if I wanted more on Sammy's end. Maybe he did the whole like kind of almost near dead babyface fighting back a little too well. But there were points where I think I was taken out of the match and I kind of lost attention, probably because I didn't expect it to go this long. But I mean, again, those were only a few hiccups. And to me, that was my biggest problem. I feel like the way the decisions were rendered were smart. I just feel like, yeah, the dynamic was great and everything else. But yeah, I would just say pacing at certain points in terms of the match itself, you know, them locking up, them doing stuff, kind of plodded along a little bit for me at times. But other than that, yeah, solid effort by these two guys.
Yeah, yeah. I can see where you're coming from. There were definitely some parts where it slowed down a little bit. But because we had to watch this separately because I had something that I had to take care of last night while you were able to watch NXT, and that's why we're doing this so late. I was able to just kind of fast forward. Like if they were in like a rest hole or anything, I had made no bones about just kind of fast forwarding through it and being like, okay, well, I see what they're doing here. And like the two different moments towards the end of the match where Sammy was getting counted out and he just barely beat the count out. Yeah, like that kind of stuff. Like I just kind of and plus the commercials, obviously, I was also able to fast forward through. So that might have made a difference for the viewing experience than why I didn't really have a problem with the pacing because I kind of controlled the pacing to a degree.
Right, which makes perfect sense. So, I mean, with that said, let's get into some specifics. I mean, again, one of my favorite things, just Joe working heel the entire time, watching him slap Sammy around, and then he would do punch combinations in the corner. This is the best I've ever seen Samoa Joe, and this is coming from a guy, people. I have seen Joe in TNA. Haven't seen much of him in ROH, to be fair. My exposure with him started in TNA when he was the undefeated Samoan submission machine and continued all the way until he got abducted by those people that was never explained by TNA. But, yeah, this heel Joe.
Such an LOL TNA moment.
I know. This Samoa Joe is just such a badass. Like, I'm hoping, and see, I read something very, something as a cause for despair, I should say, today, and that's that Vince apparently isn't high on NXT, which, surprise, surprise, I don't know how many people it's going to be shocked by that news. He apparently sees it as nothing more than a touring product, and he doesn't really see anybody coming up from NXT that could be stars. And meanwhile, at the NXT locker room, while people want to go up to the main roster to make more money, they have a lot more fun down in NXT, and I think some of them were really disgruntled after Breaking Ground, because, you know, they made a big production about Breeze being called up. That was actually the punctuation of the series, and now he gets treated like a jobber, to quote the article.
Yeah.
So if that's true, because we always say here at TwitWow, anything that we report that doesn't come directly from here, our own opinions, take with a grain of salt. But it wouldn't surprise me. I mean, that seems to fit perfectly in line with Vince's mindset, his personality. And honestly, like, that's such a shame because I think if you brought a heel like Samoa Joe to the forefront, I'd be a little less salty about the fact that a guy like Roman Reigns isn't heel right now because Samoa Joe would just be doing quality work. But then again, I feel like Kevin Owens could also be doing it, and I feel like they really haven't pulled the trigger on him like they could be doing. So it's just a shame because Joe is just at his most brilliant right now. And I'm just glad he's being able to use it in NXT rather than just waiting on the sidelines on the main roster. So I will say that much. What about you? What were some of your favorite moments?
Honestly, my favorite moments were really the few moments where Sami Zayn just kind of pulled Sami Zayn stuff to get the crowd into it. Like, just a perfect example, the first time when he was going for a suicide dive on Joe and Joe did his walk away and Sammy did the whole thing where he jumps up and does like a split-legged moonsault but lands on his feet and then backs up into the ring.
Right, right.
I love that, and that pops the crowd so much every single time. And then he did an actual split-legged moonsault onto Joe, onto the outside, which is – and I loved the way that he set that up too because Joe was running at him like he was going to clothesline him, and Sammy saw it, and he ran towards the rope, and Joe was following him because he wanted to clothesline him, and then Sammy grabs the rope, pulls it down, and Joe just goes flying over. I loved that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, here's my thing, and I've kind of come to this conclusion about Sami Zayn for myself personally, you know, watching this match and then mulling over it today because I knew we were going to be recording a bit later. Like, for me with Sami Zayn, I respect how talented he is, and I respect the athleticism and everything. I just don't think I'm that much of a fan of his, to be honest. Like, I respect everything that he does, and I'm so happy he's here. But yeah, like, I was just totally in Joe's corner the entire time, you know? I felt like I was more attentive and I pop more for what he was doing than what Sammy was doing. And again, I don't want people to think that I don't respect Sammy. Absolutely. All the respect.
Would you say that you've gotten a little bit more, I guess that the proper terminology would just be jaded by Sammy?
You know, it could be jaded. I just think it's, again, the guy's a phenomenal athlete. His matches are great. You know, no doubt about it. It's just, I really couldn't say, like, I respect him. I'm just really not a fan of the guy. Like, no matter how far he goes, it makes little difference to me. Obviously, I want everybody to succeed. But on that personal level, you know, Sammy's just going to do whatever. And I wish him the best. But guys like Joe, Owens, you know, it's funny because I feel like in terms of heels, this era is so good. And I'm just talking wrestling in general, not just WWE. And yeah, I'm just loving the crop right now, dude. It's fantastic. Because yeah. I look at a guy like Joe, I mean, going back to some of my favorite Joe spots, because you took some of the Sammy stuff, which I think is great. You know, the running face wash he did to Sammy, I thought was awesome. You know, the Uranagi in the corner where Sammy's trying to charge and Joe just catches him and he powers him down. That's what I liked about it, too. It wasn't like one fluid motion. It was almost like he really had to power him down and he slammed him down hard. And then, yeah, the muscle buster was great, which, again, to give credit to Sammy, because I'm not trying to slight the guy, selling is great. And he is such a great babyface sucking you in. Like, I've got to fight from the ground up literally every breath that I have. Has to be devoted to not just winning, but surviving.
Yeah.
And Joe's the perfect heel where you kind of break that kind of atmosphere out, you know? So again, perfect people to interact with each other, and Joe and Sammy. Sammy's dives, you know, just anything, launching himself literally just to try and get Joe down and to build something. I will say the one thing Sammy consistently does that makes me pop, especially when it's on bigger guys, the exploder suplex in the corner. Because he had it hooked in, and I thought Joe was going to counter because he was hanging on, but Sammy powered through. I thought that was really cool, especially because that was so much later in the match that in a kayfabe context, you have to think, well, how much did that take out of Sammy? Because you guys have gone so long now, what does he have left to give? And yeah, it's just fantastic, man, the way these two worked, and Joe's physicality. And I thought commentary was on point here. You know, if you're Finn Bálor and you're watching this match, what are you thinking? And now the question updated would be, if you know that Joe went to war with Sami Zayn literally for the entire show and got the victory, and he's told Finn Bálor before, and we saw the match at London, you didn't beat me, you survived me. I mean, if you're Finn, I think you've got a lump in your throat right now knowing that you're going to have to face Samoa Joe again.
Yeah, that's a great point. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just fantastic, man. Gotta say, too, to put some praise on Sammy as well, I liked his psychology in the early going of the match. When it was really, when they were trying to establish that foundation so they could kick it up into that next gear, he was working over Joe's arm, and that arm work would transition into a Mahistral cradle. So he would try and get the quick pin, but it was all built upon, okay, I'm going to weaken the arm, and
yeah,
then with the weakened
really
arm,
like
I'm going to build upon.
I thought that was really, really good psychology.
I thought that was excellent. Very sound psychology. So I really appreciated that from Sammy. I love, too, here are two things that I loved, again, showing a heel and not making a heel look like an idiot. That's why I really appreciate NXT's booking. When Sammy got Joe in the Koji clutch, Joe did try to resist, but he tapped out fairly quickly because he's like, okay, I'm not going to expend all this energy trying to resist when Sammy's still got to win another fall and we would just be even rather than him being ahead. So he taps out. I like that. I think that's good heel psychology, thinking, you know what, I'm still in the match, whatever. And then when Sammy tried doing the Coquina clutch, I like that Joe found the counter fairly quickly. I mean, I would hope that he would, given that he's used that hold for years. If you don't know your own hold intimately, that would be pretty bad. Yeah. So I appreciated that, too, because I think it was a great pop for Sammy. Like, oh, look, I'm going to beat this guy with his own hold. But then Joe doesn't look like an idiot because, well, I use it. I think I know the counter, and he controls the foot. So great wrestling on that front, too.
Yeah. Yeah, that's... I agree on that. That's, you know, I love, and I think that's really was, I mean, I'm kind of struggling for words here because it feels like we're trying to kind of fill out the podcast a little bit better, but what it really does come down to simplify it and put it succinctly, the psychology of this match was really, really good. The pacing was average, maybe above average, depending on how you watched it. And I think that they 100% they made the right decision on who won the match.
Oh, certainly. I mean, look, again, to me, it's really nothing even against Sammy, though I do have my bias and I do prefer Joe. I just think, you know, Finn Bálor is the babyface. I would be intrigued about a matchup between him versus Zayn, no doubt. I just feel like I don't know what kind of story you'd want to tell, because to me, I'd want it to be a bit more substantive than Sami Zayn just being like, well, I want to be the first ever two-time NXT champion. That's a noble goal, but I like the idea they gave it to Joe because, one, again, he's a great heel, and if you think Wrestling 101, babyface heel. And then, two, they already have that history because of London, so we're doing this again now. I enjoyed their London matchup. I enjoyed how it was booked, especially the finish, where Finn really seemed to have to give everything just to get Joe off his feet before the coup de grace. And now you think Dallas, after seeing Joe pull that off, what is Finn going to have to do to win again? I mean, even though he will be the demon and the demon's undefeated. You know, so you've got a very interesting dynamic there.
That's the big thing right there because, you know, say what you will about Samoa Joe being this dangerous guy, but at the end of the day, when Finn channels that demon, he has not been beaten yet, and he's used it so many times now, and it's never failed him.
Exactly. I mean, that's really all I have to say about this match, guys. I mean, this was One match and one show. Like Ashton said at the top of the show, NXT's answer to All Night Long. And I can only presume next week we're going to get what the commentators were kind of plugging, that being Asuka and Bayley interaction and American Alpha versus Vaudevillains for the NXT Tag Team Title No. 1 Contendership.
I think the what they were teasing was Asuka and Bayley versus Eva and Nia Jax, because we haven't seen that yet.
That is true, although... Yeah, you're probably right, because I was going to say, we didn't really hear anything about Eva or Nia Jax, but, you know, we definitely know Asuka and Bayley are going to be doing something together, whether it's teaming up, something or other. Yeah, I mean, you know that they're going to cross paths, and probably next week. So, yeah, I mean, what a show this was.
Yeah. All right. I think it's time for us to move on, because I don't want us to start repeating ourselves.
Yeah, I'm right there with you, so let's move on. High spots and low shots.
Well, I mean, high spot Joe, low shot Zane.
Exactly. So we're agreed that, which means there's only one thing left. Unless there's anything else you want to say, I'm taking us home.
I think, guys, this is kind of awkward and short, but it's okay because guess what? Lucha Underground has their final comic out, and we're going to read that, and then we're going to talk about it, and we're going to upload it before SmackDown comes on tonight, so you have something to do in between doing whatever you normally do and SmackDown coming on. And then we're going to watch SmackDown and record 2 off of that. So stay freaking tuned because stuff's on its way.
Absolutely. So, guys, with that said, this has been NXT. This has been TwitWow. The best wrestling podcast made for wrestling fans, by wrestling fans, on the web today. I'm John. That's my cohort and commentary, Ashton. Guys, be sure to comment and subscribe on YouTube. Ashton, what question do you have for our subscribers this week?
Who is going to win between American Alpha and the Vaudevillains? I know American Alpha has been kind of the kings of the tag division that haven't... They're like the uncrowned champions. But the Vaudevillains have been on such a roll. They've won, what is it now, 3 matches in a row since their turn?
I believe so, yes.
It's at least 2, it might be 3, so, you know, it's a clash of the streaks, brother.
Definitely. I mean, and this is interesting for me, because I love both teams, but I gotta go with American Alpha. By the way, quick side note, American Alpha did an interview recently. Their new attire, totally inspired by the Steiner brothers. They said they love that tag team. So,
didn't we bring that up the other week when we first saw the attire?
I don't think what you may have. I know I didn't. So if we did, that definitely must have been on you.
I feel like I definitely said something about it, yeah.
Well, if you were, they confirmed it. So I just want to put that out there. Anyway,
well,
guys,
exciting.
Be sure to take the conversation over to Pleetoff. That is pro wrestling is taking over Facebook. A lot of rabid NXT fans there. I know you'll feel right at home. Be sure to like the TwitWow Facebook page, share and interact with the content. But if Facebook isn't really your medium, we also have a TwitWow subreddit. There you will find all of our TwitWow content. And members of the TwitWow subreddit can create threads of their own on all things related to pro wrestling. However, if you want the ultimate TwitWow experience, if you want to get down on the ground level of Ashton and myself, we are both on Twitter. You can follow me at John_TwitWow. Ashton is at APond404. That's the letter A. Pond, the body of water, P-O-N-D. 404, and as my cohort and commentary said, we will see you again for our Lucha Underground comic book analysis. It is the final issue, and guys, trust me when I say we have a good bit to talk about. So until then, tune in. Peace out.